Yard here, and in today's episode of Germanator Studios, we are finally going to be building another roller coaster, and this is going to be a much more traditional roller coaster, in the sense of having a chain lift and being gravity-fed for most of the layout. Well, really all of the layout. Anyhow, we are going to be building a like a modern aerodynamics roller coaster, similar to DrachenFire. And if you're familiar with DrachenFire, you'll see what I mean. Now right here, in order to figure out how tall to make the lift hill, I basically built the shape of the drop with the corkscrew at the top, and that's how this is similar to DrachenFire, among other things. So I built all that up early just to figure out what height I needed the lift to be. That way I wouldn't have to experiment with it later on. And this starts off pretty similar to DrachenFire with that drop into the hill, but I ended up swapping it out for a vertical loop just so that way you could see the inspiration, but it's not sort of identical right off the bat. And the similarities, for the most part, end there. But this is definitely, it's a classic corkscrew coaster, and it definitely has the feel of one. It sort of, I guess, ends up being a mixture of like a modern aero corkscrew coaster, or modern aero looper, I should say, mixed with like a classic aero giant looper. But anyhow, moving on, you can see over by the path, we built a large cobra roll. And then built up the coaster to, from the, what do you call it? It's a straight track, but it's not a mid-course break run. But this part here is the mid-course break run. Anyhow, we built that up, and, yeah, not a lot to say, but I guess I'll talk a little bit about designing traditional roller coasters. This applies to any roller coaster simulator that's worth its salt, and when I say that, I mean, like, any coaster game that uses a realistic physics model, or at least a somewhat realistic physics model. but generally speaking, when you design roller coasters, some tips I have. For one thing, if your turns are taken with any amount of speed, always bank them. The faster a turn is taken, the wider it should be. And, higher up elements are generally smaller. And then lower to the ground elements are generally wider, but really it boils down to speed and pacing, which is not much of an issue with this ride here. But in general, when you're designing coasters, the slower your ride is going, the tighter and sort of faster paced you want your turns to be, because that creates an illusion of speed for the riders. Anyhow, finishing off the layout here, you can see after the corkscrews, we did a couple of turns to get back to the brake run, but I wasn't completely satisfied. I think I want it to be a little bit longer, but we'll do that in a moment. Right now, I'm just adjusting the station for reasons that I can't remember. I'm sure if I was actually watching the footage, I would have been able to tell you. Anyhow, so you can see me messing around with the different sort of shapings and everything here. What I ended up doing was I got rid of the second corkscrew and I went into a batwing element. And a batwing, as you can see, is a half corkscrew into a half loop, and then the element mirrors itself. So it goes into another half loop and out of a corkscrew in the same direction. If it exited in the opposite direction, it would be called a Norwegian loop, if I remember correctly. Anyhow, so I didn't like the speed it was being taken, so I built it one piece lower, essentially. I don't know how to describe the heights of the roller coaster pieces, but I made it one lower and built that element into the ground a little bit. And there's nothing wrong with building your rides into the ground. It's something I generally try to avoid. But it can be done, especially in this case, if you need a little more speed for an element such as a batwing. And anyhow, moving on from that, the element flowed a lot nicer and made a better sort of finale for the ride. And then you can see I was able to just do a couple more turns to get back to the final break run. And yeah, now we are making the queue line and the exit. And the exit will change that quite significantly in a little bit, and you'll see what I mean when we get to that point. Anyhow, what are we doing now? Oh, yes. We are moving forward with the storage track. And I slaved away for quite some time with this, and in fact, I should have edited down the recording ahead of time. But you can see the trial and error process I go through to get things just to my liking. So first I wanted to have like a little sliding transfer track, and my idea was that the little straight piece there would slide into place, but just the way the pieces line up in the diagonal range, I guess we'll call it, it didn't quite line up right or in a realistic way. So I decided that even though I've done this before, I've done it twice now in this series, and I don't like doing it. So the fact that I'm doing it three times in this park, I don't know. Something must be wrong with me. But anyhow, I'm going to be using our little ghost piece method, in which, it does come in handy, in which we basically create a forking track, and what you do, as you'll see in a moment, you basically create a ghost piece. I call it a ghost piece, but it's the little blue piece on the end of the rail. And you exit and save the game while that ghost piece is still there, still in sight. And then when you reload the file, so you can see me do it here, this is good timing. When you reload the file, that piece will be there as a solid scenery piece. An emphasis on scenery piece. It is not considered a roller coaster rail. Like, it's not considered part of the roller coaster you're editing. And the one caution, I will make this caution again, know ahead of time where you want that piece to be, and then of course delete it when you want to place those pieces back of the main ride. But know where you want that piece to be, because once it's there, even if you delete it, it will always come back the next time you load the game, and there's no way that I know of to get rid of it permanently. So once it's there, it's there. So make sure it's where you want it to be. Anyhow, where was I guess that's everything I needed to say. And that's why I deleted it to begin with, because I know it'll be back. And when it comes back, the next time you reload, once you finish the ride, ideally if you've lined it up properly, which I did there, that piece will be merged with the roller coaster piece. But it won't cause any issues with your ride, or your ride won't crash into it. Like, it won't crash when it goes through it. So it's a good way to create sort of a merge track or a transfer track or whatever you want to call it on your rides. But anyway, along here I am building the storage building. And I ended up saving this as its own little custom scenery piece because I built it one block further over than I wanted. In order to do the building and the transfer track the way I wanted, I didn't want to interfere with the supports of our bat wing, so I ended up moving everything over one block, and you can see how I did that too, shifting the station pieces over. And when I build storage tracks, I like to use the station pieces, because if I decide to take a train off of our ride, I like to put one in the storage track just to have continuity, so it's not like it's missing entirely. And you can do that with the station pieces. However, I, for whatever reason, I think you can only do up to one piece. I don't think you can do more than one train in your storage area. I could be wrong. I could be remembering wrong, but to the best of my memory, I believe that's true. Nevertheless, for continuity's sake, I like to do that. And generally speaking, if you design your rides properly, you should never have to have less than two trains on the track, unless you're at like, or unless you're building a really tiny park or something. Anyhow, we're just going through here with some chain link fences to denote the low zones and keep people out. And luckily, there weren't too many true low zones. And when I say true low zones, I mean areas where the train dips below the rider's head level. So the station, and I think a little lower than the station, like the next height lower, I don't call true low zones, because in theory, one of the peeps in the game could walk under it and not hit their head on the track. Obviously, it's a little more complicated than that, because you know, if someone could reach up and touch the track with their hands, then that still counts as a low zone. But generally speaking, I try to denote low zones as anywhere where the track goes low enough, where the train goes low enough, that it could contact somebody standing nearby. And of course, then you put fencing around those low zones to keep people out, because we operate a safe park here at Germanator Studios. Anyhow, I should probably talk about what's on screen now, and that is the station. Most of these buildings look pretty much the same, even if they're just a little bit different from one another. Of course, right here you can see me using the little dormer windows over the entrance and exit doorways, and that's so if it is raining, the rain falling off the roof does not fall onto the guests' heads. The dormer roof will sort of split the rain or split the water onto the either side of the doorway, so it doesn't fall on anybody. One design tip I would have, though, and you'll see it here with this little tunnel building we create, is that if you want to use the decorative edge pieces on your roof, which I do, you can't use a dormer with those. There's no decorative edge piece for the roof. That's also the dormer piece. So going through the edges there, we can't have those. So if it's raining, riders might get their water droplets smacking into their eyeballs or something. And you might be thinking that's an oddly specific statement, and but it has happened to me riding roller coasters on wet or rainy days. Actually, the most interesting occurrence was when I was at Europa Park riding Load On Timber Coaster. The ride goes below its big entranceway, and the entranceway has a water feature, and somehow a rogue water droplet had fallen down. When I was riding, it smacked me right square in the eyeball. And it was not a painful experience or anything, but it was just bizarre and a little uncomfortable. So, anyway, weird side tangent there, I know. Point being, if it's a rainy day in Germanator Studios, you've been warned. If you're going to ride. And speaking of if you're going to ride this ride, it does not have a name yet. So if you guys have any suggestions for names, let me know in the comments below. I know there are like 16 of you who watch these things without me promoting them. So if you're watching this far, which I hope you are, go down in the comments and tell me what I should name this thing. Something colonial related, because this is the colonial section of our park. Anyhow, moving on, we're working on the planters here. I shouldn't have to explain it at this point, because it's the same planters I've been using throughout the entire park. And, yeah. Anyhow, now I don't know. Oh, we've done it again. I've reached the point where I don't know what to talk about, because I'm doing something I've done 100 times and doesn't need explaining. Anyhow, I guess in regard to suggestions, don't just suggest names for the coaster, but suggest, we have that big triangle area in the middle, and I don't want to put a building there. I think I want to put a ride of some sort there, but if you guys have a good idea for what should go there or what could go there, let me know, and I will definitely consider it. And what else? Ah, yes. Now we are putting a little fence along the back wall, and I just went with the trusty old pine wood fence. I think it's the pine wood fence, because you can color it, and I made it colors that fit the rest of the theme, the colonial theme. It also sort of fits the color scheme of our park, the blue and the white, so it works nicely. I don't know if I'll keep it, but, you know, I think it looks nice, so for now we'll keep it, and if we need to change it, we will. And finally, we're at the point where we are changing up the exit ramp. When I said it's a big change, I mean a big change. So I went in the opposite direction completely, and that was so we could fit in, say it with me now, a gift shop. So, of course, we want guests we want the peeps to spend their hard-earned money at our park and make as much money as we can. So they need a place where they can pay for a picture of themselves on the ride when they get off. And that's what we're building for them now. And of course, the building style is just the same as it's been the entire time. Also, look at that. Do you know, if you may remember, I've struggled with placing wall pieces alongside ramps. It just does not like to work in this game, and for some reason it worked flawlessly there. So I don't know what sort of black magic was happening. Maybe what kind of witchcraft, if you will, because we just did our spooky section. But it worked, and I went with it. So then I put in a couple stalls there, some custom stalls that we'll theme later, and put a little storage closet on the other side. And, of course, put windows along the front to make it look nice, and put roof pieces in. And that, in and of itself, is all pretty straightforward, so I don't think I need to talk too much more on that. Here you can see me continuing with the fences of the low zones right there along the pre-lift area. Obviously not as hazardous because the ride's not traveling at high speed, but a massive roller coaster train will not stop for anything except the brake run. So better safe than sorry, and better to block it off. And what else? I guess just deleting that little path along there, the old exit ramp, and filling it in with some little hedge pieces. And then, now, in the little recession in the ground over here, I am putting in a block wall, a gray-colored block wall, just to make it look like it was dug out intentionally and has support. And that, if you have your coaster sink into the ground like this a little bit, I would say this is probably the most important step of making sure it looks realistic. And, of course, in addition to that, in a moment, we will paint the ground with our trusty old concrete color. And, or concrete paint, I should say. And that makes it look much nicer and much more realistic. And with that, I'm going to leave you with a POV. So I will see you guys in the next episode. And have a wonderful rest of your day. Goodbye.